And welcome to the fourth meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee of this year. A formal decision under item one, which is simply to take items four and five, where we'll be discussing evidence that we've heard in private. That relates to the request in relation to an anonymous submission, and the other to the evidence we're shortly to hear. Are colleagues content? We are. Thank you. We move then immediately to item two, which is the consideration of continued petitions. And the first of those is petition number 2035, which is to recognise legal control of generalist predators as a conservation act. And that's been lodged by Alex Hogg. And good morning. Mr. Hogg joins us this morning at our request to give evidence in the petition, which we last considered at our meeting on the 25th of October last year, and it calls on the Scottish Government to officially recognise legal control of abundant generalist predators as an act of conservation to help ground nesting birds in Scotland. And Mr. Hogg is petitioning on behalf of the Scottish Gamekeepers Association and has indicated to the committee that he would like just to make a short statement before we move to questions. So good morning, Mr. Hogg, and if you're settled, when you're ready, over to you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for having me here today. In my lifetime, I've watched favourite species decline. Today, there are far more predators, far less wildlife managers, and far less ground nesting birds. Unless the remaining wildlife managers feel more supported, we will lose more of them and birds in the remainder of my lifetime. Given the government's written response to this petition, I feel a ministerial statement confirming support would be appropriate. This would send a signal to wildlife managers that their work in conservation is valued, that wildlife managers are recognised as contributing to nature recovery aim, and to make it clear that Scottish Government does believe, through both actions and words, that predator control can be fundamental to species conservation. This message, I feel, has been lost. Scottish Government recently removed two key tools, which were snares and trained dogs. Foxes are proven to predate ground nesting birds, and the banning of fox snares will hasten the curlew's demise. Using foot packs of trained dogs to control foxes has been strictly licensed. No licences have been granted for conservation. Parliament researchers should cost out the public money spent on habitat for ground nesting birds compared to sums spent on predator control. They should also assess the outcomes for species. This would enlighten us on one, where the government priorities are, and two, where these priorities have achieved the right results. And I don't believe they have. I think we can do both habitat and predator control and conservation and do better. Thank you.
Mr. Hogg, thank you very much. That's very helpful. And thank you too for the submissions that you have lodged to the committee. I'm going to invite my colleague Fergus Ewing to lead the questioning this morning. Mr. Ewing.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to Alex Hogg. And in the interest of transparency, I should say that Alex Hogg and I have known each other since he first gave evidence to Lord Watson's bill, which I believe was 25 years ago, and have become friends since. And I'm also a supporter of the Scottish Gamekeepers Association, although I can't remember whether I've paid my annual subscription. Having made that clean breast of it, as it were, could I just move to questions? And first of all, could I just ask Mr. Hogg, why predator control is required as a species conservation tool? I think this is the main point of your petition to acknowledge that that's the case. Could you explain why it's required and talk us through the main methods used by gamekeepers and what role gamekeepers in particular play in species conservation?
Well, a typical week this week, say, would be to your curlews and lapwings are just starting to show up back in the moor again. And we will have spent the winter keeping on top of stoats, for instance, by using box traps. We'll now be spending our energies spent trying to control the fox with the tools that we've got left in the toolbox. And that is many hours early and evening, sitting out 7 days a week, all weathers, just trying to protect any ground nesting birds, because they're so vulnerable now to the different species that are just, the populations went through the roof with ravens, say. Foxes are always on their eyes, stoats and weasels, things like that. We have to control them, otherwise you end up an absolute desert. Just to give you a picture, I drove down, was helping Brian Burrows, who's on a committee with the Golden Eagle Project in the south of Scotland. We drove yesterday down through Lyham, which is 25,000 acres are responsible for now. It's a nature reserve at Lyham. It's been bought over. We never seen one lapwing. We drove 20 miles south to Teesdale and hundreds of lapwings, hundreds. And this is what will happen if we don't take care of things by controlling predators, we will end up with a desert.
Could I just ask you to confirm that in Teesdale there's predator control, but Lyham there isn't?
Yeah, absolutely.
So where there's no predator control, then it becomes a species desert?
Yeah, it really does. Nothing there at all.
What sort of species are at risk most, do you think, if there is an absence of the historic predator control carried out?
Golden plover, lapwing, curlews, grouse, any ground nesting species is going to be vulnerable.
Is that because the predators regard the eggs as sort of breakfast, lunch and tea?
Aye, and they can't get... If you can imagine a wee bird nesting up in a tree or that, or a hedge, they've got at least a bit... They can get a wee bit safety, but when you're on that ground, you're stuffed.
It's very clear. Thank you. The Scottish Government recognise, they say, that predator control is a component of species conservation alongside other measures. In your opening statement, you called for the Minister to confirm support, that they value the work that keepers do, that what you've described assists in nature recovery, and you've also asked, I think, for information about the cost of alternative proposed methods or methods that are carried out, such as habitat control. And no doubt we can pursue all of these because you've asked us to, so I hope that we can perhaps do that. But can I just ask, when you say that you want us to, as a committee, to explore how predator control as an important component of species conservation should be officially recognised, do you have anything specific in mind? Are you asking for a ministerial statement, a letter to the SGA, evidence before this committee perhaps, where the Minister may be given an opportunity to confirm all of the matters that you've requested? Have you got something in mind that you would like to embody this official support?
Would love if we've got a ministerial statement. If you can imagine, at the minute, there's massive grants for forestry, say, £8,000 a hectare. It's maybe reduced a wee bit, but no predator control. There's huge grants for agriculture. It would be nice for it to all get intertwined and recognised.
So I believe there's an agricultural bill coming forward and that the government are then next year, I think perhaps sometime, going to come forward with specific proposals about how financial support to the rural economy should be dealt with in future. Are you saying that you think that predator control, as recognising its species conservation value, should be recipients of an element of this funding?
What I think is, if you could imagine a farmer being given a reward, say, for a curlew nest fledging, So it would get £1,000 or £2,000 a nest. Or, as soon as the farmers heard that the lapwings and curlews were in that predator control grant scheme, we would see an uprise in numbers again, I think. It really would.
So you think there should be a kind of an element of financial provision which would allow more predator control, which in turn would protect species at risk like lapwing, curlew, plover, capercaillie and so on?
Definitely, because if curlew was going to go extinct, it's just become extinct in Wales nearly. It's so serious.
Right. Could I just ask one final question? I'm sure other members wish to pursue other points, but and I do have a constituency interest here in relation to the capercaillie. Mr. Hogg has stated that despite the millions, tens of millions, I think, expended in the aim of trying to protect and see the capercaillie population not fall but grow, despite all that, and huge amounts of money over many years, you say that we've lost over 50% of the remaining birds in 5 years. Is that right? Can you expand on that?
Aye, the capercaillie, I think, is going to go extinct as well. It's just, it really is on a knife point. If we don't act now, we've got other problems as well. We've got pine martens, which you can't legally kill, but we should maybe get a licence to remove them live, things like that, working around the different areas where the things are more protected. But we have to try and pull all the stops out, Fergus, to save this capercaillie, and that is by predator control.
Otherwise, caper is likely to be extinct. I think Nature Scott have said that as well, that it is likely to become extinct if the current trends continue. Is that right?
Yeah, it's really worrying.
Despite the fact that tens of millions of pounds have been blown on this already, it's just completely wasted, is it? Is that the case?
And they should have employed keepers right from the start and got right. And same and on poor RSP bear control and stoats and weasels on just off the mainland there at the top of Scotland. What was it? Oh, try to mind the island's name, but there's a big control there. They should probably have employed keepers. They would have done it far, far quicker and better.
They did employ keepers, then we might have some chance of seeing seeing a species, including the caper, recover, instead of which we've had the great caper caper, as it were, where millions have been blown.
Uh-huh.
OK, I'll finish there, thanks.
Mr. Hogg, I mean, I represent an urban constituency. My life has all been urban. So I'm somebody who enjoys the countryside but has never had to live in the countryside or depend on the countryside directly, although I probably do depend on it directly, but have an indirect appreciation of how I depend on it directly. So I've read, interestingly, a couple of books that were given to me which have talked about the way in which there has been almost an evisceration of certain bird populations. And I have two or three questions, I suppose, that I'd be interested in your reflections on, because clearly this has been an occupation and a vocation for life for you. Why do you think that legislators and urbanites have become so sentimental about foxes and other predators in the sense that they don't wish to see them controlled in an effective manner, but to be nourished and treasured almost? And yet the species to which you're referring almost seem to have an anonymous profile in the minds of people who pursue those objectives.
I think it all relates back to Walt Disney a wee bit and things like that. Yeah, we really could do with getting the kids on board, and we do a lot of, on our charitable side, we're going to teach schools and colleges and all sorts, but it's just a perception that we have to try and change. It's so difficult. Even speaking at my local school at Peebles, only 100, maybe 1,000 kids come through that day, and there was only 100 knew what a gamekeeper was. So we're getting away from the real things in life.
I think you've broken new ground this morning, because I think that's the first time the Scottish Parliament's condemned Walt Disney, but I'm sure that's a headline in its own right. But in a sense, that has created what an artificial and slightly sentimental view about certain animals and not others.
Aye.
And I suppose then, in the sense that these birds have been a vital, well, maybe not, maybe that, try not to be, but there have been an ever-present variety of species in our countryside. What is the practical consequence, however regrettable, but what would be the practical consequence of our losing these species from the Scottish countryside?
I just can't imagine losing them. We have to act now to save them. Can you imagine? It must be in your biodiversity plans to stop that, and if we don't, we're really, gosh, I wouldn't like to think.
So you've lived all your life with these species being part of our natural habitat, and obviously have a passion about it. What is it that characterises your appeal, the appeal of lapwings and curlews and capercaillie to you?
Take the curlew, it's a call. You know, you go out in the morning, early morning, you're waiting to try and protect them at their nest, and you hear them calling. Even not to hear that call each spring would be so sad. And it's just, I just kind of think we should be facing this. We have to act. And it would be nice if the government would recognise all the efforts that we put into saving these species.
And in the, I mean, Fergus Ewing referred to an association with you over 25 years, and organisations like Nature Scott, have you seen a change in the kind of centre of gravity within organisations like Nature Scott over the time that you have had to engage with them?
Okay, just to be frank, Nature Scott in the past 10 years have been no help, really. I spoke to Robbie and Cairnhan and works in Nature Scott years ago. I said, look, we have got one big problem coming up here, and that's ravens. Can you please, you know, get your head around it? And then they're just like, nobody wanted to put their head above the parapet. But lately, gosh, maybe because the biodiversity thing's going to collapse, they've really been, we had them at our AGM there, and they really are wanting to try and resolve this. So Colin Galbraith was there, and the last, who's the chief executive, was there, and so was the licensing chap, Donald. And it sounded like they wanted to help us and get on board and get on the front foot. One of the ways I think we could maybe get this going faster, because we're going to run out of time, is to recognise areas as being zones. So, like, so when I went to Teesdale yesterday with hundreds of lapwings and curlews, we could immediately see it was because of the gamekeeper's efforts, but it could be a zone. So they could zone areas where curlew and lapwing are so strong at the minute, and then Nature Scott could come in and say, right, let's protect it even more. Give you the licences. Get on the front foot. It's very difficult to get licences. So if they could get on the front foot, and let's try and beat this.
OK, thank you. Colleagues getting questions. Maurice Golden.
Thank you, convener. Yesterday on Net Zero Committee, we heard that the Scottish Government used Wikipedia as a source to explain policy in relation to the Environmental Court. Mickey Mouse policy making, you might say. But with respect to this area, I wonder if you could explain if you have confidence in the research and understanding for evidence-based policy setting by Scottish Government and or Nature Scott.
I'm very choosy with some of their science, and you know, the white hares was a perfect example. White hares on keeper ground, there is thousands, but the Scottish Government protected them, And we had all the science as well, but they would not listen to it. You know, everything was on our side, and I just, no, nobody took a notice. And let's protect the white hare, which is now going to be in. There's no white hare, white hares in Abernethy at RSPB Reserve, things like that. So some of the science is believed and some is, disbelieved.
Thanks, that's very helpful, Mr Hogg. Just regarding the Nature Scot review of Capercaillie conservation, lethal predator control is not the primary Nature Scot recommendation for a range of reasons, including that, and I quote, widespread removal of a suite of species is not compatible with the overall biodiversity goals as set out in the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy. I wonder if you could give your thoughts on how we can protect biodiversity and what the primary methods for that might be.
Well, I read that report, and when they said widespread, that's where I thought zoning comes into its own. It's not widespread, it's really zoned in on the capper, say, and it could, all the things, all the tools in the box could be used then if it's understood to be to save the capper in that zone. So it's not widespread.
Thanks, Mr Hogg. Thank you, Convener.
You said you were in Teesdale. Now, I do think I visited Teesdale. I think waterfalls are something that are particularly renowned in Teesdale, I seem to recollect. Am I in the right place?
No.
Obviously people there will be aware of what's happening in Scotland in comparison. And what thoughts and observations have people there made about the impact that they think they can see it having in Scotland, and what concerns have they got themselves in consequence?
I think we've had to jump through so many hoops with the grouse moor licensing that people are just so frustrated now. And we feel like second-class citizens almost in Scotland, because especially the keepers have been bashed and battered, and we've jumped through all these hoops to do all our snaring training, all our firearms training, everything we've done, and we're still getting bashed. And we'd just like that recognition that we're valuable for this biodiversity crisis.
OK, thank you. Mr Ewing, did you want to come back in?
As far as the zoning goes, I mean, it's always good, I think, convener, to have specific recommendations from witnesses rather than a sort of generalised commentary. If we were to take Capper as an example, and you know, plainly in Strathspey, there has been traditionally a Capper population. I mean, how big would the zones be? Are you able to expand upon how the extent of the area of the zoning would be assessed? And would it be helpful that local gamekeepers were part of a process to assist in identifying which areas should be subject to this type of measure and control, and that gamekeepers should be required to be consulted in order to get the right areas zoned?
Fergus up at the estate, if you spoke to him, and you would quickly find out much area you would need and things like that. And yeah, it's really important you have the local keepers on board.
Good. So really, gamekeepers could not only carry out the control, but they could also be the kind of key advisors because of the work they do on the ground. And really, only they have that knowledge. Is that right? Because all of those who criticise predator control tend not to actually work in the countryside themselves, unlike you. So keepers would not only do the work, but actually be instrumental in guiding the policy and shaping which areas really need to be protected, to be zoned, to protect the songbirds and capper and other species that are at risk and might, in fact, become extinct otherwise.
That would be fantastic if we got that recognition.
Is there anybody, colleague, is there anything you'd like to say further to us, Mr. Hawke?
No, I don't think so. Just Otterburn was another one. If you guys want to get your head round it, it was a 10-year experiment down just over the border by Gamecon, Sevenset, and you can see the plots where they've done it. They would remove predator control. It's really important science, and it really shows that without us, you're lost. Yeah, we're biodiverse. We're curlews and lapwings.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for joining us, taking the trouble to come in this morning. Can I thank you, on behalf of the committee, for your service to the countryside and the species that inhabit it? Your passion is very evident to us on the petition that you brought before us, and I know we're all grateful for that. Thank you very much. And I shall now suspend briefly. We continue, and the next of our continued petitions is petition number PE1900, which is access to prescribed medication for detainees in police custody. And this has been lodged by Kevin John Lawson. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that all detainees in police custody can access their prescribed medication, including methadone, in line with existing relevant operational procedures and guidance. And colleagues, we'll remember this is an important petition we've been discussing, which we lasted on the 31st of May last. And at that point, you'll recall it raised concerns about NHS Grampian and an inspection of police custody units within NHS Lanarkshire. The then Minister for Drugs and Alcohol committed to conducting a rapid review of each health board to ascertain the extent of issues relating to controlled drug licences across Scotland. Now, we've since received an update on the outcome of this review, which revealed that Grampian, Lanarkshire, Western Isles, Dumfries and Galloway, Orkney and Shetland NHS boards did not have controlled drug licences. NHS Western Isles and NHS Dumfries and Galloway confirmed that they have existing practices to prescribe medication that don't require a controlled drug licence. NHS Grampian were striving to submit an application by the end of May last year. NHS Highland submitted an application and were awaiting a Home Office inspection. NHS Lanarkshire were in the process of seeking a licence as their custody suites in Motherwell and Coatbridge did not have a licence. NHS Orkney and NHS Shetland have planned a review of the supply of medications within custody facilities, which will help to inform whether they require a licence, and this review was due to conclude 6 months from the time of writing. The response also revealed that NHS Orkney and NHS Shetland could not confirm that they had written policies and effective practices in place which ensure that every detainee has access to their prescribed medication. NHS Western Isles stated that it would create a pathway for prescribing controlled drugs to patients in custody. And now we understand from the clerks that an update in each health board has been shared directly with the petitioner, not just recently, but more recently than the update that we've received here. And the petitioner has since provided us with a further written submission. And colleagues will recall that this was a petition which led to an admission by the Scottish Government that we couldn't actually demonstrate that prisoners in detention were actually receiving the medication that they were, to which they were entitled, and that this had led to a tragic outcome in one particular case. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider writing to the Minister for Drugs and Alcohol Policy to ask for an update on the work of relevant health boards in obtaining controlled drug licences and implementation written policies on access to prescribed medication, and how she intends to monitor the progress of work going forward on the NHS Grampian, NHS Highland, NHS Lancashire, NHS Orkney and NHS Shetland boards.
I think I might be right in saying that the update the petitioner received was in his capacity as a constituent of the minister. Is that correct? And of a minister, and that had led to that. But I think it would be useful for, in fact, essential for the committee to have as up-to-date a position as we possibly could on a position that I think we regarded as being one of importance that we'd identified in this session. Are we agreed on Mr. Torrance's recommendations? We are. Petition 1947 to address Scotland's culture of youth violence, lodged by Alex O'Kane. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to address the disturbing culture of youth violence in Scotland, and we considered this at our last meeting on the 21st of February. And also, in addition, we've gathered a range of evidence from Youth Group 6VT, from the petitioner, from families with direct experience of youth violence, from the academics Dr Gillen and Dr Batchelor, and then at our evidence session last time round, from Police Scotland, No Knives, Better Lives and the Scottish Violence Reduction Unit. And I really do want to thank all of those who have contributed to date. Obviously, those who have contributed to previous sessions have been watching our two roundtable and evidence sessions, and we've received a further submission from the petitioner challenging the evidence that he heard from the academics that violence is stable and low, unquote. And he points to issues with reporting and states his view, and I quote, that it is more difficult than ever to report a crime. Obviously, we've had an opportunity to reflect on the evidence that we've heard, and I wonder, I'm sure we want to keep this petition open and pursue the issues within, if there are any suggestions from colleagues as to what we might do. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if you bear with me, because this is going to be quite lengthy. I wonder if a committee could...
Mr. Chowdhury, have you got some suggestions as well?
Yeah.
Well, I'll let Mr. Torrance go first, and then if you could perhaps add any that you think would be right.
Okay. Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider writing to the Minister for Community Safety seeking a clear information on the whole system approach to youth offending looks like in practice with addressing repeated incidents of violence perpetrated by a young person, including details of the varying pathways for responding to repeat predators and with what investigation, charging, sentencing, rehabilitation and diversion looks like in these pathways, how the history of violent behaviour is considered when addressing youth offending, and how policies and processes across mental health, education, social care and justice system work together to put predators to positive pathways while protecting victims in their communities. Reflections on whether the Minister recognises the challenges to reporting noted by a petitioner, an indication on whether she recognises the petitioner's concerns that recorded crime statistics may reflect lower reporting rates rather than giving an accurate picture of the levels of youth violence, information on what victims can expect by way of transparent communications and trauma-informed support at each stage of the process, and finally, information on what the Scottish Government is doing to address young people using social media to threaten violence or encourage participation in violence.
Now, that was quite comprehensive. Do you have anything else to add, Mr. Chowdhury?
Yeah, just to add on the last point, Mr. Torrance says, last session, Police Scotland said that a lot of social media companies are from abroad, and it's kind of bit difficult to get it engaging with them. So can the Scottish Government do anything or ask any questions that if there is something they can get involved with?
I think there certainly is merit in seeking to get an opinion from the Scottish Government on just what impact social media is having in this particular area of concern and what they feel they can do, and in the event they don't feel they can do, where they think it would be that responsibility lay, or what would need to change in order for them to have the ability to act more decisively. So I yield on Mr. Chowdhury's suggestions on that basis. Mr. Ewing.
Yes, sir. Just rereading the evidence given from Will Linden of the Violence Reduction Unit and Emily Beaver from No Knives, Better Lives, at page 15 of the evidence official report. Both of them referred to the value of schemes, for example, of cashback and schemes provided by smaller grassroots organisations. And Emily Beaver said that the programme had recently changed, the cashback programme, and shifted money away from some of these smaller grassroots organisations. And there was also uncertainty about the longevity of funding across the third sector generally from year to year rather than longer. And Will Linden echoed that and supported her, stressing the difficulty for third sector and community organisations. I know this is a difficult area, and it's not always clear who ultimately is responsible for ensuring the survival of these schemes. But just in the evidence that Mr. Torrance has quite rightly sought, can we specifically ask for the Community Safety Minister to set out what is being done in order to ensure that the work done by these voluntary third sector organisations is better funded on a longer term basis and valued? Because I think it, from my recollection of my time in that role a considerable time ago, admittedly, much of the work done really does help to turn around young people who otherwise are on the cusp of more serious offending.
I'm just looking over that evidence again, and quite right, that was quite a central point of the discussion that we had, so I think that would be helpful. Well, colleagues, are we agreed on the various suggestions that have come from across the committee? We are. Then we'll move forward, keep the petition open, and move forward on that basis. Our next petition then is petition number 1952, and this is specialist services for patients with autonomic dysfunction, lodged by Jane Clark, calling on the Parliament to urge the Government to instruct Scotland's NHS to form specialist services training resources and a clinical pathway for the diagnosis and treatment of patients exhibiting symptoms of autonomic nervous system dysfunction, dias autonomia. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 17th of May last year, and the recent submissions we've now had from the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health highlights the results of a questionnaire to a sample of general practices, which included questions on the clinical guidance managing the long-term effects of COVID-19, which found that 60% of responding practices were aware of the guidance guideline and 25% were aware of the implementation support note. The content of the implementation support note is being reviewed and updated. The University of Leeds has been contracted to support the initial evaluation of long COVID services in Scotland, and this work will provide an analysis of demand and capacity, analysis of longer term outcomes for patients, and compare differences in service models where possible. Now, the petitioner has stressed the petition concerns all patients with dias autonomia, not just those with long COVID. And she notes that there are no specialist autonomic clinics in Scotland, and that cardiology consultants have told POTS UK that they do not have the expertise to manage patients with dias autonomia. She welcomes the training resources available to healthcare professionals, but would like to make it clear that these are not a suitable substitution for specialist services. So, do colleagues have any comments or suggestions? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider writing to the Scottish Government asking specifically whether it will work to create specialist autonomic clinics in Scotland, and if not, how it can be confident that the expertise in local and regional clinics services is sufficient to treat those with autonomic dysfunction.
Okay, are there any other suggestions from colleagues? Are we content to proceed on that basis? Colleagues, we are. Our next petition is petition number 1967 to protect Loch Lomond's Atlantic Oakwood shoreline by implementing the high road option for the A82 upgrade between Tarbert and Inverarnon. This has been lodged by John Urquhart on behalf of Helensburgh and District Access Trust and the Friends of Loch Lomond and the Trossachs. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to reconsider the process for selecting the preferred option for the planned upgrade of the A82 between Tarbert and Inveraran, and to replace the design manual for roads and bridges, the DMRB, based assessment with the more comprehensive Scottish Transport Appraisal guidance. We last considered this petition on the 17th of May, 2023, and we agreed to write to the Minister for Transport, and we also looked then at the suggestion, I think, of Jackie Bailey, who joined us at options for a site visit. We've received a response from the then Minister, now Cabinet Secretary for Transport, which refers to previous submissions setting out the development and assessment of the A82 Tarbert to Inveraran scheme and the Scottish Government's view that the stag-compliant assessment has already been completed. The Minister states that the Government is not willing to carry out a reappraisal of their preferred route option, as this would repeat work already carried out and likely lead to considerable delay and additional costs. The Minister also notes that the Transport Scotland have considered the alternative option put forward by the petitioner, with the Government not considering this to be a viable option to alternative to their preferred option. The petitioner has commented that the Minister's response does not add anything new to the evidence we have gathered so far, and notes that both route options pose considerable engineering and environmental issues, with the Scottish Government's preferred option requiring the extension of viaducts affecting the tree line and wildlife along the banks of Loch Lomond. The petitioner does, however, welcome the Minister's assurance that stakeholders will have an opportunity to provide formal comment or objection during the statutory consultation period, and offers once again to facilitate a visit to the site. Now, the committee has also received a submission from Stuart Cordner in support of the petition, sharing concerns about the impact of the low road option is likely to have on local tourist business. I'm not certain myself that a site visit is something that would assist us, given the fairly strong direction from the Scottish Government at the present time. But do colleagues have any comments or suggestions? Mr. Chowdhury.
Yeah, I mean, to write to the Cabinet Secretary for Transport seeking further details on the anticipated timetable for progressing the draft road orders and statutory consultation. Also, to ask the Transport Scotland be invited to give an evidence to the committee about why stag appraisal has not been carried out.
Well, I think it would. I think in the first instance, I would write quite specifically to Transport Scotland on that issue, rather than bring them before the committee. I don't think we necessarily want to schedule an evidence session at this point on such a narrowly defined point. But I think we could ask them quite directly, because there does seem to be a difference of view as to what actually has taken place. And you know, I would quite like something a bit more definitive, Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I would respectfully agree that I don't think a site visit is required, nor that we hear from oral evidence. But I do think that there appears to be a slight conflict of evidence as to exactly what analysis has been done by Transport Scotland in relation to the apparent option of the high road, because the impression I get from just rereading the correspondence is, and submissions, is that in fact Transport Scotland have carried out some analytic work of this and have concluded that it's not practical. So I think clarification of that in a letter would be very useful. And also, I would also just like them to confirm what the cost of a stag report would be, how long it would take, and whether they think that that might cause further delay to the project, which I know is whilst the petitioners have very sincerely set out objections, there are a far larger number of people in the West Coast, in Oban and Fort William, who use this route as their link to the world. And the Tarbert to Inveraran stretch is arguably the worst section of an A road in Scotland. And routinely there are accidents, delays, wing mirrors being damaged. And I think many people feel anxious about driving that section, which I did for many, many years when I represented Lough Erber. And therefore there is a huge number of people that want the A82 to become a proper road. And I just thought it's useful, whilst respecting the petitioner's wishes, to put that in record, convener, just out of perhaps a sense of balance.
Are we content to proceed on that basis?
Agreed.
We are. Although, Mr. Ewing, you are showing your age with wing mirrors. I think it's door mirrors more likely these days. It's been some time since wing mirrors were legal, actually, on vehicles. but nonetheless, I understood the point that you were making. Petition number 1979, establishing an independent inquiry and an independent national whistleblowing officer to investigate concerns about the alleged mishandling of child safeguarding inquiries by public bodies. This petition has been lodged by Neil McClellan, Christine Scott, Alison Dickey and Bill Cook, and I think I can see some of the petitioners at least in the gallery this morning. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to launch an independent inquiry to examine concerns that allegations about child protection, child abuse safeguarding and children's rights have been mishandled by public bodies, including local authorities and the General Teaching Council. Gaps in the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, and establish an independent national whistleblowing officer for education and children's services in Scotland to handle these inquiries in the future. Now, we last considered this petition a month ago on the 7th of February, where we held a roundtable discussion with the petitioners, Bill Cook, Alison Dickey and Neil McClellan, and the whistleblower, Brendan Barnett. Three were present, one online. During the roundtable, we heard about a need to robustly investigate and resolve safeguarding allegations before undertaking policy reviews. We heard about the failure of public bodies to follow national guidance due to its non-statutory status and an inconsistent approach to information gathering and sharing between relevant agencies. We heard about concerns that allegations are not fully investigated at the time, with inquiries taking place many years after the event and the impact this has for confidence in local authorities and public bodies, about how the role of the Children and Young People's Commissioner in Scotland could be strengthened, and how the creation of a national whistleblowing office for education and children's services could provide a route for individuals to access guidance, support and a structured procedure when raising concerns. Now, following the evidence session, we've received a new submission from the petitioners requesting a private evidence session to further explore issues they felt constrained from detailing more fully in a public setting. There are two key asks of this petition, the first being the call for the independent investigation of unresolved allegations about child protection. The petitioners have given us a flavour of these outstanding allegations and the challenges experiences in resolving through existing process. However, it may be that the committee does not offer the appropriate forum to take forward detailed consideration of this particular ask. The petition also calls for the creation of an independent whistleblowing officer for education and children's services, with the petitioners indicating in their most recent submission that they will provide further follow-up information on accountability and resourcing issues we discussed. Now, having had the opportunity to reflect on the evidence we heard last month from the petitioners, do members have any comments or suggestions for immediate action that we might consider taking? And members may be aware that there was a late submission as well, which you will have received with your papers today. Mr. Torrens?
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee could consider writing to the Minister for Children and Young People and keeping the promise to recommend that the Minister meets with the petitioners to discuss the concerns about unresolved allegations relating to child safeguarding, and to ask the Minister what consideration the Scottish Government has given to Children and Young People's Commissioner Scotland's suggestion of developing a new principle for individual professional and agencies responsible in relation to child protection issues. I wonder if the committee would also consider writing to the Scottish Public Serviceman's Ombudsman to seek information on the effectiveness of an independent national whistleblowing officer for NHS services and its views on whether a similar approach should be adopted for education of children's services.
Any other colleagues have any suggestions following the evidence that we heard? Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I think just the witnesses from whom we heard, Mr. Cook, Mr. Barnett and Alison Dickey, indicated that one of the problems about public inquiries is that they take such a long time, and that therefore part of the rationale for having the proposed whistleblowing service that they advocate is that things can happen at the time and not after the kids become adults. And frankly, the events have long drifted out of the memory of those involved. And I just wondered if we could perhaps, in writing to the Children's Commissioner, draw that to the Commissioner's attention specifically, because this does seem to be a gap, and also to the Minister's attention, because, you know, unless this point is granted, it is dealt with, I don't think we really would have made much progress with this petition. So I just wanted to raise that point, because it was one that was made in the evidence that, that we heard, Convener.
Yeah, I can recall, Mr Ewing, that you drew particular attention to it in the questioning that we had at that stage too, so I think that would be, with reference to the Edinburgh Academy case, I think you cited at the time, that it would be useful to incorporate that as well. Colleagues, any other suggestions from members? So we will keep the petition open, and we will pursue with the Minister and the Ombudsman these particular issues at the present time. Are we agreed? We are. Thank you. Our next petition is petition number 2009 to ensure fair access to Scottish universities for all residents in Scotland and the UK. And this was lodged by Caroline Gordon. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure fair access to Scottish universities for residents in Scotland and the UK by reviewing university business models and Scottish Government funding arrangements. We last considered this petition at our meeting on the 17th of May last, where we agreed to write to University Scotland, the Scottish Government, the Commissioner for Fair Access and Individual Universities in Scotland. And while Glasgow Caledonian University states that its aim is to be allocated more funding places, it notes that growth would be focused on increasing widening participation in Scotland. Edinburgh Napier accepts that the funding arrangements mean that the approach could be described as an upper cap on the overall number of places. However, it states that it does not recognise the scenario presented in the petition, where all places for Scottish domiciled students on a degree programme are filled by students from a widening participation background. The Commissioner for Fair Access's response notes that he intends to review funding arrangements, but has not found evidence to substantiate the petitioner's concerns that funding arrangements block access for Scottish domiciled students, or that such arrangements lead to students pursuing higher education elsewhere in the UK. University Scotland's submission recognises that for some courses, demand will be so high that suitable applicants are unable to achieve their first choice. However, the submission also notes that the data indicates that applicants are not missing out on accessing Scottish universities. On funding, it highlights that public investment in each Scottish undergraduate has fallen by 27% in real terms since 2014, and that spending per student should be the focus rather than increased places. Robert Gordon University, University Scotland and Edinburgh Napier state that there is not an issue of too few funded places, with some highlighting the need for increased funding allocation per student. And on this point, Robert Gordon's submission points out that the Scottish Funding Council reduced the number of non-controlled funding places by 1,000 in the academic year 23-24 in response to under-recruitment of students across the sector. The petitioner's written submission requests that the committee seek data from each university on a number of points related to the number of applicants from different backgrounds being accepted into specific courses across Scotland. We were joined at the last hearing of this petition by our colleague Michael Mara, who is with us again this morning, and before the committee consider what action we might further take, I'd be interested again to hear from Mr Mara. Mr Mara.
Thank you, Convener, and can I thank the committee and the clerks for the support they've given in the pursuing this petition. I have to say that the evidence that's been supplied, particularly by the individual universities, has really added, I think, to the understanding of the issue in specific context. So it's greatly appreciated the work that the committee has undertaken so far. I would hope that there's further that can be done to open this up, and I'll maybe set out some of that if I can. And I've reflected on the submissions that have come back from the various issues, various consultees, and as I say, I think that the individual universities context is useful. I would say that both the Commissioner for Fair Access and Universities Scotland in their submissions to the committee reference data but don't provide the data with them. And I have to say that I've found some of that data difficult to find, particularly, I think, around the Commissioner for Fair Access's assertions around the too many Scottish domiciled students having to pursue higher education, personal financial costs elsewhere in the UK. He believed that there was no evidence of that, and references data, but did not provide the data. And it would be useful, I think, for my constituent and for the general discussion of the policy if he were to be able to do that. And I would appreciate if the committee might consider asking them to provide that data, as well as University of Scotland reference some data in their submission as well. I think it's fair to say that I do not believe that the general issue of the funding model that is imposed upon universities in Scotland will be resolved by this petition, convener. I think that is a political decision, and I think that actually the submissions we've had set out some of those general issues that are around it, the decrease in funding per student over that period of time, the 27% figure, which I know will be deeply concerning to many people. But I think that the issue is about what other data we can obtain that can help applicants to better inform the decisions that they might make. I do think that's particularly pertinent in the coming year. We have a significant budget cut being made to higher education institutions, which I think on a basis, I think it's £28.5 million, which may further decrease the number of Scottish domiciled students that can gain access. So it makes that competition ever tighter. So I think that it's really key, and I think the relevance of this has increased actually since the budget process has come through. I would hope that the committee would take that into consideration as well. I would support my constituents' view on this, that I think that universities should be publishing more data about the makeup of courses. So whether it be international students, whether it be Scottish domiciled students. I think of that for one reason in particular, that a Scottish student applying to universities has five options when they fill in their UCAS form. That's been the case for a very long time, certainly since I applied to university in the mid-1990s. What we've had in the evidence so far is it shows that on some courses, that person making that application had zero chance of accessing that course on the basis of the evidence from the previous years. Now, some of those cases, I think, are very isolated, and the universities, I think, are keen to express that. It's a rare occurrence in their view. I think that it would be a really solid case for that information to be published proactively to best inform applicants as to whether they are using one of those five bullets, those five chances that they have, whether they're using it properly. Do they have a real chance of gaining access to the course that they want at the institution they want, or do they not? To me, that's an element of fair access. So perhaps that's something that the committee might consider asking for views on, views of University of Scotland, views of the Scottish Government, and views of the Commissioner for Fair Access. Not to say that the committee should endorse that position, but just whether that might be something that could be explored. I think that that information makes it a fairer system all over for everyone concerned, whether that be Scottish domiciled students, international students, and also widening access students, so that they can best understand where they should engage with the process and how they were going to be supported in what they do. So that opening up of the data, greater transparency, I think is probably the next logical step around this petition. If the committee was viewed to support that, that would be most welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Mara. I think that's a telling point. I certainly have constituents who, with five applications, more informed understanding of to whom they might actually reasonably apply with an expectation of success based on some data that actually verified that would be useful. So I would think that a very useful thing for us to try and seek to try and bring into the light of public scrutiny. Are colleagues content to try and pursue the further advancing of data, as Mr. Mara suggested? We are. Yep, thank you. Thank you very much. And we will keep the petition open and seek to progress on that basis. Thank you very much. And no doubt see you again when we next consider if we're fortunate enough to receive the information that we've requested. Thank you. Petition number 2012, the remove the need for follicle-stimulating hormone FSH blood tests before prescribing hormone replacement therapy, HRT, lodged by Angela Hamilton, calling on the Parliament to urge the Government to remove the need for follicle-stimulated hormone blood tests in women aged 40 to 45 who are experiencing menopause symptoms before hormone replacement therapy can be prescribed to relieve their symptoms and replenish hormone levels. Last considered again on the 31st of May last year, when we agreed to write to the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists and NHS Education for Scotland. Now, the Royal College for Obstetricians and Gynaecologists refer to expert advice from the British Menopause Society that in accordance with NICE guidelines, follicle-stimulating hormone blood tests should be considered but not required to diagnose perimenopause and menopause in women aged 40 to 45. NHS Education for Scotland have confirmed the online learning package on menopause and mental welfare is being researched and written, and it expects the resource to be available to GPs and primary care practitioners by the end of this month. And we've also received a submission from the petitioner, which shares the experience of a patient seeking menopause treatment and support who felt forced to seek private medical care and faced further difficulties with follow-up care when their treatment was passed to their GP. So, a number of organisations responding, advancing some of, I think, the issues raised in the petition. Do colleagues have any suggestions or comments for action? Mr Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders on the basis that NICE guidelines state that for women aged 40 to 45, HRT can be offered without the need for blood tests when other menopausal symptoms are present. There is now a specialist menopause service in every mainland NHS health board with a buddy system in place for islands health boards. And also NHS Education for Scotland has been commissioned to create an online learning package around menopause and menstrual health with resources expected to be available for free to GPs and medical practitioners by the end of March 2024.
Mr Golden.
I respect what the member says, but particularly given the makeup of this particular committee, I wonder if we would keep the petition open and write to the British Menopause Society seeking their views on the issues raised by the petition, including whether they have engaged with NHS Education for Scotland in the development of the online learning package being provided to GPs and medical practitioners in Scotland.
Mr Chowdhury?
Yeah. I think we should write to the Menopause Society seeking their advice.
Mr Ewing, do you have a view?
Well, I did really wonder if there was much more we can do for the reasons that Mr Torrens said, but I mean, if members want to write to the Society, then, you know, I guess there's no harm perhaps in that.
I mean, I think Mr Golden was pointing out that we are a very masculine committee, and that perhaps that might mean that we are not giving due consideration, as others might, to some of the issues being raised here.
Convener, I would withdraw my recommendations.
So,
the majority of the committee.
I understand the reasons, I think, why Mr Torrance has, but at the same time, I think Mr Golden makes a perfectly reasonable point. So we'll keep the petition open and write as suggested in relation to the issues in the petition. And I note that, I suppose it did occur to me when I was updating colleagues, we can also, I think, just check with NHS Education for Scotland that this package, a resource, does materialise at the end of March. By the time we next consider the petition, we will know whether, in fact, that package was properly introduced, which I think is a reasonable additional step. Petition number 2014 to revert to the appeal system used in 2022 for SQA exams. This was lodged by Elliot Hepburn on behalf of Moffat Academy students, calling on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to implement a revised SQA appeals process, which takes into account evidence of the pupils' academic performance throughout the year, particularly prelim results. And we last considered this petition on the 31st of May last year. Subsequently, the SQA's written response explains that from 2014 to 21, the appeal system mirrored the 23 system in that it did not consider alternative evidence. It highlights that the appeal system in 2023 was developed following an extensive evaluation of the approach taken in 2022. Separate from this, an examination exceptional circumstances consideration service is available to pupils who are unable to sit exams or whose performance is affected by personal circumstance. Now, evidence suggested that the 22 appeals service, which considered alternative evidence as part of the appeal process, was not fair to all learners, increased the assessment burden. The Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills has indicated that the SQA has evaluated the 2023 arrangements and was expected to confirm the arrangements for 2023 2024 before the end of last month. And obviously matters have moved on, and I imagine people are more concerned now with the appeals process that will apply in the year in which we are now considering exams. I don't know whether that was confirmed at the end of February. I'm unaware of that fact, but I wonder whether colleagues have any suggestions in relation to the actual petition before us. Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the SQA described the appeal process that operated in 2022 as an emergency response for a single year, and based its approach for the 2023 on the outcome of a full review of the 2022 approach. Also, that it used alternative evidence and appeals raised issues of equitable access, fairness for absentee candidates, and the volume of work the service generated for a wider system, and responsibility for the appeals process rests with SQA, which operates independently from ministers.
Colleagues, given that the actual definition request of the petition was in relation to a year now past, are members content to close the petition on the basis suggested by Mr. Torrens? We are. Then we thank the petitioners for that. Obviously, it's open to anyone to raise a fresh petition in relation to arrangements in a separate academic year, but we look to the statement that was expected from the Scottish Government in relation to arrangements for 2024. That brings us to agenda item 3, which is consideration of new petitions. And again, for those who might be joining our proceedings online this morning, having heard that a petition that they had submitted was to be considered, can I say that in advance of so doing, we do ask the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament's Independent Research Unit, SPICE, for a briefing and comment in relation to the petition. And we do that because historically in previous sessions, if we didn't, that was really the first thing that the committee then recommended we do, and that very often led to an extended delay in our consideration of the issues raised. So, the first of those petitions this morning is petition number 2056, introduced legislation allowing Scottish ministers to intervene on the hire of public land, lodged by Stephen Gall, calling on Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce legislation providing ministers with the power to call in and potentially override council decisions on the hire of public land for large-scale events. Mr. Gall tells us that his business has over a number of years tried to hire public land for large-scale events, but these requests have been refused by local authorities, and suggests that his is not the only business this is impacting. As the SPICE briefing notes, while this Parliament has legislative competence to enact primary and secondary legislation that impacts local authorities, it is generally up to local authorities to determine how they use their land and property. The Minister for Local Government and Empowerment and Planning has advised that it is not a matter for the Scottish Government to intervene on, and refers to the Verity House Agreement, which includes a commitment for local and national government to respect each other's democratic mandates. Now, we've also received a response from the petitioner, Mr. Gold, commenting on the Minister's response and emphasising the call for a change in the law, and noting that the Verity House Agreement is not legally binding. Colleagues, do we have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Ewing, are you thinking of contributing here?
Well, I was thinking that whereas the specific action that the petitioner seeks from us is not one that I think can readily be accommodated. Nonetheless, I think questions are raised by general questions about, you know, in what circumstances can an events body that seeks to hire land but gets a blank refusal from local authorities, you know, why is that? And what's the rationale behind it? And I think more information, therefore, would be useful. I do appreciate that we don't wish to trespass on the Verity House Agreement and local authorities' responsibilities at all, but I think reasonable questions have been asked by the petition, so I would be reluctant at this fairly early stage to close it down without at least doing justice to the petitioner and try and pursue the queries. Therefore, so I think writing to COSLA, to the Association of Public Service Excellence, and to Event Scotland, that's the Visit Scotland Directorate supporting the Scotland's events industry, seeking their views on the action called for in the petition, including any guidance they provide to local authorities about developing policies for the hire of public land. And if I may say so, in addition to that, I think it would be useful. I'm not quite sure from whom we might obtain this, but to see if there are any private sector tourism bodies, possibly the Scottish Tourism Alliance could assist us here, convener, who could provide useful information, because you know we all want events to be displayed in public land. Local authorities are under a lot of pressure in various ways and funding and so on. But I think the petitioner does raise a reasonable question, so I would be reluctant just to close it down without making some sort of effort to get closer to, you know, if there is a real problem here with reasonable requests routinely being turned down peremptorily by local authorities.
Are we content to Mr. Torrens?
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if we'd consider writing to a Showman's Guild, because the Showman's Guild is probably one in Scotland that use higher land off the local authorities more than anybody, that is to see what difficulties they've had.
I mean, part of me does wonder whether some local authorities, perhaps potentially smaller local authorities, which sometimes are in locations where such permissions might be being sought, feel that their own resource is such that it's easier to say no than it is to say yes, because saying yes involves them in the administration of certain matters for which they feel they currently haven't got the capacity to take forward, and that you know is partly what may underpin some of their views. And I'd be interested if Cosley felt there was any substance to that kind of consideration as well. So yes, I think with the various suggestions we've made, we'll keep the petition open. While we accept that some of the evidence that we've received and the comment from the Scottish Government, there are issues here potentially that it would still be useful for us to explore. The second of our petitions, for which colleagues will note they have a late submission on the table before them this morning, is to ensure petition number 2064 to ensure that under 16s charged with rape are treated as adults in the criminal justice system. And this has been lodged by Julie Mitchell. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that under 16s charged with rape are treated as adults in the criminal justice system. The Spice briefing explains that certain offences for children over the age of 12, and under the age of 16, must be jointly reported by the police to children's reporter and the procurator fiscal. Rape is considered to be an offence which requires joint reporting, and the procurator fiscal decides whether prosecution will proceed within the adult justice system. Regarding the sex offenders register, where a case proceeds within the adult criminal justice system and results in a conviction for rape, the notification requirements apply regardless of age. However, the length of the notification period is reduced for those under the age of 18. The Lord Advocate is reviewing diversion from prosecution as it relates to sexual offences to consider whether it is being used appropriately. The Scottish Government's response to the petition notes that its policy position is to keep children out of the criminal justice system wherever possible and appropriate. However, it recognises, and I quote, the need to strike a balance between supporting children who come into conflict with the law and ensuring that our communities are safe and that victims are supported. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would like to write to the Lord Advocate seeking an update on the review of diversion from prosecution for sexual offences and make reference to issues raised in the petition as part of any letter to the Minister for Community Safety on petition.
On petition number 1947. So are we content to take forward the recommendation of Mr. Torrens, but also to combine that in relation to the issues raised in relation to petition number 1947. Yeah. Mr. Ewing?
Just as while supporting Mr. Torrance's recommendation, we might, in addition, when writing to the Lord Advocate, seek from her some data, evidence, as is available, of, without going into names, but of cases that have arisen over the past few years and since fairly recently, I think, legislation was passed in this area, because this is an area of huge public concern. There's absolutely no doubt whatsoever about that, for the reasons that the petitioner sets out in the supplementary submission that we've got. So I think, as well as the review of the diversion, which I think was instructed in last July, so it may not have really been completed yet. It would be really useful to find out how many cases there have been of rape by under 16-year-olds. How serious is this? How many instances have there been each year? And any further information about that, because that I think would help to provide a bit more background. But plainly, any cases can have tragic consequences for the victims, and that's what the petitioner has, I think, emphasised in the supplementary petition.
I think that's reasonable. Try and find wording that would allow us to establish that. So thank you very much. We will keep this petition open and pursue the issues raised as recommended. Petition number 2065, to improve and prioritise pedestrian safety, lodged by Shauna Rafferty, calling on Parliament to urge the Government to improve and prioritise safety for pedestrians by widening pavements and reducing street clutter, introducing a mechanism to report pavement parking, and improve visibility of pedestrian crossings. Spice Briefing notes that responsibility for the maintenance, management and development of most of Scotland's streets, including footways and crossings, rests with councils. Transport Scotland's response to the petition points to Scotland's Road Safety Framework to 2030, which created targets for key priority groups, including pedestrians. Investments are highlighted in the submission, including funds for new and improved pavements, safer junctions, improved place design, and projects for casualty and risk reduction. Transport Scotland is working closely with local authorities to assist them in preparing for the enforcement of the pavement parking ban. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider writing to Transport Scotland to ask how Scotland's active travel vision to 2030, the National Transport Strategy and Road Safety Improvement Fund, will work to directly address street clutter, and whether it has considered a national approach to improving the visibility of pedestrian crossings. I wonder if the committee would also consider writing to COSLA to seek information about the capacity of local authorities to widen pavements, reduce street clutter, improve visibility of pedestrians crossings, enforce the pavement parking ban, and implement safe system measures through the Road Safety Improvement Fund, and ask how it intends to share best practice or measures to improve pedestrian safety across local authorities.
Suggestions from Mr. Torrance. Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I would support that, but in doing so, I mean, I'm aware from my own constituency that the pavement parking ban has caused real practical issues for residents in residential areas where the street is narrow and where there are cars usually on each side of the road, and where if there is some abuttal of the pavement, unless a car can mount the pavement to some extent, it becomes impossible for people to actually have a car, and that in turn means some people are effectively isolated, particularly elderly people or those with impaired mobility and those with disability. And therefore, this does seem to me to be an issue that's been raised with me, and has quite severe consequences. So whereas safety of pedestrians is very important, there is another side to this. So in writing in taking up the suggestion that Mr. Torrance has made, I wonder if we could ask if this issue has been considered, and whether local authorities have received complaints such as that which has been raised with me in other parts of Scotland. And if not, I think perhaps some further work might need to be done on this, because I suspect this will come back and we'll probably find a petition on this topic before too much longer.
Mr. Ewing, I think that's my experience as well with constituents. Although the parking ban has not yet been enforced in my constituency, despite the excited interventions of Mr. Greer, who is continually invoking the local authority to proceed. But there are a number of streets where the application of the law means that emergency service vehicles aren't able to access the street, which is a clear issue, one that could have been foreseen. But I think, on the other hand, the other issue which I think makes this all the more difficult is the continued increase in the size of motor vehicles, which really are, you know, When I think, Mr. Ewing, of the cars with wing mirrors that you and I passed our driving test on, and as a Ford dealer back in those days, the Ford Capri, the Ford Cortina, the Ford Escort, the Ford Fiesta would occupy half the space, I think, of a modern vehicle, both in length and width now. And therefore, I think it's not a surprise when vehicles park in the streets that there's no road left in the middle for anybody to drive through. Vehicles have certainly got a lot bigger, unnecessarily so in my view, with a consequent impact on the road network and infrastructure that has to support them. However, having got that out of our system, we will proceed. Mr. Chowdhury, were you trying to come in there? Do you drive a particularly big vehicle, Mr. Chowdhury?
No, I don't. Not with the big mirrors, but I wonder if you watch the old cowboy movies, you can see the big wing mirrors or the are sticking out. So,
Some people are even driving camper vans these days.
That's one thing I've been asking you guys to organise that for me. But I haven't been in a camper van yet. But constituent who wrote to me regarding what we were talking about earlier on about pavement parking. Do we think? I mean, some of the local authorities has already put a ban on. Parking ban on pavements, and there is a lot of issues. Is there any data on the councils who has banned the pavement parking? If so, can we request somewhere?
I suspect not yet, because I think it's very early. But I think Mr. Ewing is probably correct to suggest that we might anticipate a petition at some point in relation to the unintended or intended consequences, in some cases, of the legislation that has been imposed.
I'll be very happy if we can organise a camper van.
Petition number 2069, to ensure accuracy of statements involve informing child welfare reports. It's the last of our new petitions today, lodged by Nicole MacDonald, calling on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure the accuracy of evidence gathered by child welfare reporters by introducing a requirement that statements provided as part of their report are signed as a true account. Ms. MacDonald raises concerns that where child welfare reports contain inaccurate or misleading information, individuals rely on their solicitor to challenge inaccuracies. And if they don't, there is a potential for the court to be misled when making its decision. The Spice briefing highlights the Scottish Government's 2016 Guide to the Child Welfare Report, which notes that the reporter should only ask for information relevant to the remit set by the court. But as the petitioner also notes, if someone does not agree with something in the report, then the solicitor should raise this with the court. It also noted that the Children's Scotland Act 2020 provides for a system of statutory regulation of child welfare reporters, although the detail of this regulatory regime is still to be determined, having been delayed, in the minister's words, by budgetary pressures. The Minister for Victims and Community Safety also tells us that a working group on child welfare reports will be set up to help inform any changes to current practice and the long-term policy on child welfare reporters, while a previous working group rejected the suggestion that interviews with child welfare reporters should be recorded. The Minister will ask the new working group to consider this point and make recommendations. So, an interesting series of issues, some interesting comments back. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrens?
I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government is setting up a working group on child welfare reports to inform any changes of the current practice and longer-term policy on child welfare reporters. This bit is key, and we'll ask a working group to consider the petitioner's ask in relation to recording of interviews.
And perhaps engage with the petitioners too, I think we might request, if that were possible. On that basis, our colleagues content? We are. Thank you very much. That concludes the public aspect of our business this morning. We look forward to those of us who follow our proceedings joining us again on the 20th of March, and I suspend the meeting.